solder or drill, and I'm looking at the technique, oh boy, I could do that for my job, you know, put together something like that. I've heard presentations from several economic students, from international studies and environmental studies majors, and it's just been hugely exciting. So I think that as we move forward, one of the things to do is look back on a day like today and say, yeah, just like that. You know, that's the kind of thing we want to do. One of the things, by the way, that I think those of you who are presenting today should be ready for is widespread acclaim. I think one of our jobs is going to be to put what you're doing very publicly on places like our webpage so that people can see it. So if you have any sort of doubts about what you want out there, get them resolved fairly early, because this may, who knows, you may go viral. You know, people may be talking about you nationwide. So we have an interesting program for you today. I've been looking at the description of the book and waiting to hear a little bit more about where we're going with this. And we also have a wonderful musical presentation today. So what I'd like to do is get out of the way so that we can continue with the rest of the program. But well done, everybody, today. Very, very nice.
Anyone speaking after President Jensen is going to have to move the microphone down a little bit. I'm David Bayo. I'm a professor of music and also this year's chair of the John Wesley Powell Student Music Conference Committee. As an artist, I'm pleased to say that this event features the arts as well as research. And I want to make sure everybody's aware that at 3 o'clock today, art students are going to be giving presentations on their original work in the Merwin and Whately Galleries in the School of Art. So we hope many of you will be able to get over there. We're featuring another art form next on the program, an original composition by an IWU student. Annie Wagner is a double degree student. She's pursuing both a Bachelor of Music and Viola Performance and a Bachelor of Arts in Psychology. Each year, we take a look at the pieces that students have written that year, think about the outstanding pieces that would be a particularly good match for this event, and Annie rose to the top this year. So please welcome her anyway.
Thank you. is Callahan, member of the John Wesley Powell Committee, and it is my distinct pleasure to introduce today our guest speaker, a longtime colleague and close personal friend, Regina Psaki from the University of Oregon. We've been collaborating for over 25 years at various conferences and over various publications. Regina is a specialist in Italian and French literature of the Middle Ages. She works in medieval feminist scholarship. She's an accomplished translator, and especially as a pedagogue, she focuses on questions of the continuity between the medieval and the modern, alterities of the Middle Ages, and also its understandability, its recognizability. Gina did her BA at Dickinson College in Pennsylvania, with her MA and her PhD in medieval studies from Cornell. She is not only a professor of Romance languages at New Oregon, but she holds an endowed chair in Italian language and literature. Today she's going to be talking about a fairly recently discovered medieval romance, which mixes questions of nurture and nature, of gender bending and cross-gender boundaries and roles, a romance of the 13th century. And I'll leave it at that. Her title is The Boy Who Was a Girl, Nature, Nurture, and the 13th Century Maiden Knight.
For 25 years, he has been leading a gentle revolution in how we study medieval lyric poetry. He's been leading it with implacable determination and surgical precision. Professor Callahan is central in the integration of the study of medieval poetry and the study of the music, to which medieval poetry was almost always sutured. Ignoring the music is idiotic, as if we were to study only the lyrics of Broadway musicals or of hip-hop or of pop songs. Take a second to imagine your favorite song stripped of its music. You're left with something like this, a song I heard recently in the movie Whiskey Tango Foxtrot. I can't live if living is without you. I can't live, I can't give anymore. Okay, so not really impressive, right? I rest my case. Like songs, the imaginative fictions of the Middle Ages, the Arthurian stories, were composed not for reception in silence, in solitude, and in the library. Instead, each one was composed for delivery to a listening audience, whether through music, dramatization, or recitation. Each one Maiden was a sound event in multiple live incarnations before ever it was a text preserved in a manuscript. Connecting us with the records the past has left us, and then bringing the past off those pages, is what Professor Callahan and most humanities research does for us. Of course, research is fascinating and seductive and irresistible. It's a mystery. The mystery genre is right up there with oxygen in the culture we've created for ourselves. History itself is often presented as interesting precisely because it's a mystery. I don't know if you've noticed this, but when you look at the History Channel or the History Magazine or the history section in the bookstore, the words they use to sell us, the idea that the past is interesting, is the language of the mystery genre. The mystery of this, the riddle of that, the secret, occult, arcane, other thing. Hidden, shrouded, veiled, lost, forgotten, and that ever-favorite, suppressed. Retrieved, rediscovered, retraced. In other words, there is, we are a culture that seems to value the mystery. It's our defining fictional genre. I fell in love with research when a medievalist, V.A. Colvey, visited my undergraduate campus to share his mystery with us. Colvey was an English professor, and he gave an electrifying talk that connected medieval biblical exegesis, interpretation of the Bible, to the visual arts that represented or illustrated biblical passages. Just so you have a bit of color, since you have to be out of the sun, I thought I'd show you a few images. He wanted to show how artistic representations could help us see how medieval intellectuals understood the Bible, and more importantly, vice versa. His example was Psalm 52, well now it's Psalm 51. And it begins with these words. It's in Ecclesiastes, Dixit incipiens in corde suo non est Deus. Corrupti et abominabilis facti sunt in studiis suis. Non est qui facit omni, non est qui suera. The fool said in his heart, there is no God. They have been corrupted and made abominable in their pursuits. There are none that do good, not even one. So the psalm, the beginning of the psalm mocks the unbeliever. And just because the medieval world is so beautiful, I wanted to show you the Latin and then the French translation of this incipit, this beginning, in a lovely psalter. Here's the folio of the entire folio. All the images illustrating this psalm show the same cluster of details, the same iconography, and the mystery that Colvey wanted to solve was, what is the fool always shown eating? Right? The fool says in his heart, there is no God. And we've always got the same iconography here, the club, and the rags over the head, and the bare feet, and the fool eating some round thing. What is he eating? Here's another image with those same details. As you see on the left, the fool is standing in front of the king and is shoving something round into his mouth. Here's an image of the fool, understood as the court fool, the jester, but still with the club and the round thing, eating it. And after looking at hundreds of images illustrating this, Colvey concludes that it is a stone. And this he gets not from the images, but from the biblical exegesis. It's the exegesis of the Bible that helps us understand what is being shown here. He says, what the fool is shown being invites a variety of interpretations, a cake, a cheese, a loaf. We wonder why a fool would eat cheese. I mean, cheese food. But my first guess was that it is a stone, an intuition I can now verify as authentic and medieval. And Colvey set this up as though it were almost in all sense the only medieval chivalric romance about a female knight, and one who was raised from her first day on earth as a boy. Now this is atypical. You wouldn't do that to your children, or maybe you would. Let me just say a few quick words about the chivalric romance genre. Its dates you can see here in the 12th century. This is its heyday. We still have chivalric romances, but its heyday is these 350 years. It first appears in Old French in rhyme, in octosyllabic rhyme couplets. Da 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 da. Its average length is 6,000 to 10,000 lines. Some are much shorter, but some, alas, are way longer. Prose romances come into the picture in the early 13th century, and the romance genre spreads to all European languages very, very quickly because it's fun. It was their version of the mystery. Chivalric romances are stories of maturation, social, personal. They usually focus on a young knight trying to find his place in society, define his identity, choose his lady. Choosing your lady is important, yes, still. Noble protagonists, okay, this is an enlarging mirror for the aristocratic class, makes them look perfect. Arthurian settings, right? King Arthur, best king ever. They're stories of fantasy and wish fulfillment, and the knight in them encounters obstacles that might be tangible and real, like money problems, or they might be magical and symbolic, dragons and fairy mistresses from the other world. The Wallace novels, the Romance of Silence, dates from the early 13th century. It's an imaginative fiction. It's on a secular topic. And it has the typical aristocratic blend of themes, such as who should inherit lands and money and titles? What is it that determines nobility? And what is the proper relationship between aristocrats and monarchs? But this romance adds something that almost no other does. What is it that makes men and women different from each other? Yeah, we're still wondering about that, as we'll see. The hero, Simons, is heir to the Count of Cornwall, trained as a knight, and becomes the best knight in the world. But Simons has only ever been treated, known, dressed, and perceived as a boy, and she grows up to become, wait for it, the best knight in England. Nature has made her a perfect woman, but nurture, noratura, has made her a perfect man and a perfect knight. The author brings these two allegorical figures out on stage to squabble about which one is going to be dispositive in determining her character and her destiny. Nature and nurture quarrel. In making this perfect knight a woman, bless you, our author asks, are many women different because of nature or because of nurture? Now, by tradition, talks on the Wallace of Simons begin with a plot summary because nobody knows the book. Before I start writing, I ask, how many of you have ever heard of this book? Two, three. How many of you have read it? For me, this is good news because I'm constantly trying to talk about this to people who don't know it, to inspire somebody to make a damn movie. This would be such a good movie. And of course, I already have casting ideas, so talk to me later. In the prologue, we meet the narrator, who teaches about the depth of generosity and honor in modern courts. Then he starts his story. King Maiden of England marries a Norwegian princess, E su, se non spalmons alla mia umana, cestila alla vente all'ana, alla fondina e alla mise. Multum gardi ora mise, devon preferere stasier, fondres istras, praes, calcier. Earthing in Greece, the child, silencia, is made by Dame Nature into the perfect woman, and Dame Nature gives her the beauty of a thousand other women. Now this image, 15th century image, looks like a woman killing a baby, but in fact this is Dame Nature forging one at her forge. Babies are made of molds in this image. Now, when as the narrator puts it, nature comes to silence, this is a big euphemism. The child regrets his deception and wants to end it, and nurture it turns up and hashes it out with nature, and silence decides to remain male for the advantages it brings, and also because he doesn't know how to be a woman. I should mention that the narrator always calls silence he. So this is an image of nurture teaching boys. Silence runs away from home to learn to play music. He figures that's a unisex skill. And he far surpasses his teachers. He returns to his parents, and who sent him to the king's court. Queen Femme comes on to him. He's a very handsome young man, without success, however. She then accuses Silence of trying to rape her. As a punishment, the King of Maine sends Silence to France, carrying a letter demanding his own execution. And then this is a trick for the vengeful queen. The King of France refuses to kill Silence, and instead makes him a knight because he's so valorous. Silence returns to England to save his own king, Maiden, from his rebellious counts. Femme again comes on to Silence, again rejected. She's not quickly undated. She insists that her husband punish Silence. They order him to capture the wizard Merlin or die trying. Since it is known that only a woman's trick can capture Merlin, they are hoping Silence will die trying. Silence traps the magician. When he brings Merlin to King Maine, the magician reveals that Silence is in fact a woman, and that Queen of Femme's companion, a nun, is actually a man in disguise. King of Maine has the queen killed. He marries the virtuous Silence. He restores women's right to inherit. It takes only 3 days to restore Silence's perfect, beautiful female appearance as well. Happy ever after. I'll be telling you more about the romance as I tell you about the history of its reception. It was only discovered in 1911 in a manuscript tucked away in the attic of a stately home in Nottinghamshire called Woolerton Hall, and it remained almost completely unknown and unstudied until Lewis Thorpe edited it and published it in book form in 1972. When the romance Silence burst on the scene of English language medical studies in the early 1980s, it was love at first sight. It's a case study for how certain works from the past remain invisible until our concerns catch up with theirs. The concerns that brought this romance into focus were initially those it had in common with first women's studies and post-structuralist theory, and then medieval feminist scholarship and gender studies more broadly. As these approaches were established in Silence scholarship, it generated a new attention to the ways in which the text was grounded in and reflected its own historical and material matrix. Since then, the roman de Silence has also been adapted for performance in various media, a critics saw the text as working deliberately to preserve the programmatic ambiguity with the inaccessibility of determinate meaning in this medieval text reflecting the abyss between pre-Cartesian and post-Cartesian ways of reading. But there were strong parallels between medieval and modern and post-modern epistemologies and aesthetics and narrative technique. Modern and medieval texts concur in their construction of gender, narrative open-endedness, polysemy, and questioning the primacy of the sexed body in gender identity in order to privilege indeterminate meaning over universal signification. Here's to privilege indeterminate meaning over univocal signification, we have this example, the boy who is a girl. And the narrator doesn't use this phrase to mean the boy who is really a girl. He means the boy who is a girl. Now these are normally binary opposites and they can't simultaneously be true. But for the narrator, they absolutely are true because Seamus's gender cannot be decided as really this, but looking like that. She is a boy and she is. And you see from the line numbers there that's repeated throughout the text. Postmodern and premodern are more similar to each other than either is to the modernity that stands between them. Women's studies scholarship took the romance's sexual context as much more a focus in itself than as a metaphor for poetic practice and linguistic difference. Women's studies tended initially to focus intently on the look of the plot. The premise that a girl would be reared as a boy and not merely pass as a male knight, but surpass all the other male knights. As you heard, the plot depends absolutely on the writer's and the reader's willingness to entertain the hypothesis that what substantially differentiated men and women was upbringing and acculturation, not innate essence. Nurture, not nature. Modern medievalists knew that they were perfectly willing to entertain that hypothesis, but they expressed astonished delight that many critics concluded that the author almost certainly endorsed greater freedom of movement and of choice for women, having posited that nurture, not nature, might determine what women can do or how they will end up. Some even put forward the possibility that a woman wrote it. In the next section, we'll look at some rationales for and against the idea that the romance's author writes from a pro-feminine, if not necessarily proto-feminist, position. Incorporating a feminist optic into medieval studies was not easy or automatic. That's when I went by. Medieval studies was initially quite resistant to an approach it saw as so rooted in 20th century concerns. In the late 1980s, when work on Seamus was revving up, modern feminine medieval feminist scholarship formed a learned society with its own journal. Society members, conference sessions, the electronic discussionalism at FemEL also promoted the visibility of this romance. Two English translations in 1991 and 1992 got the romance into English language courses and research agendas as well. The emergence of feminism as a focus in Anglo-American universities gave the boy who is a girl a natural audience once the romance became known. Around 1975, when the number of feminists studying medieval literature could be counted on the fingers of both hands, textbook accounts routinely linked the vogue for idealized female figures, such as romance heroines and allegorical goddesses, with a supposed rise in the status of medieval women. By 1990, feminists were legion, and this consensus had largely reversed itself, in other words, to thinking that the rise in romance heroines and allegorical goddesses was a compensatory mechanism for a loss of status for women in the Middle Ages. Identified and spotlighted that compelling plot mechanism, girl raises boys for a night. Feminist criticism moved in closer to examine what the author might be telling us about that hypothesis. On the one hand, the romance much criticism along the spectrum, but ultimately it's not that helpful because no critic is writing on romance's position on women or its status as a conservative or a contestatory artifact are unaware of the evidence that challenges their position. They simply weight different passages and emphases differently in identifying the text's center of positive value. Indeed, critics writing on romance are not, obliged to choose sides. Many conclude that the text embodies both complicity in and subversion of the status quo, that both contradictory positions are simultaneously upheld, the boy who leaves the girl. Catherine Terrell states that position most clearly. She says critics disagree so fundamentally about the poem's gender politics because gender itself is a radically unstable concept in science. Ultimately, it is impossible to pin down the text to any coherent notion of gender. Its contradictions are irreconcilable. It would be great if you could hold that thought for a few minutes. Medieval secular texts rarely try to specify a single univocal meaning. Instead, they give local interpretations or deploy markers to signify the kinds of questions to be asked of the narratives. The Roman de Silence sets out cues for our interrogation of the text, and this is the modus operandi of medieval secular texts in general, not just this one. Finally, the question of where on that specific spectrum to locate romance has been superseded, I think, by an awareness of how many more spectra are set up and problematized in romance. Queer theory, in particular, has repositioned the debate on the sexual politics of the romance. A debate which had rather uncritically posited the binary heterosexual male / heterosexual female as the principal opposition in the text. But beyond gender studies in general lie new worlds of Silence criticism to be read and written, such as the crucial issue of not only sex, but class, rank, and status as natural. Are nobles and commoners different because of nature or because of nature? Beyond gender studies. The romance has moved beyond its role as a focus solely for gender criticism and is mined also for information on a host of issues, including child-rearing, itinerant minstrelsy, legal issues surrounding marriage, diplomatic immunity, feudal obligation. In other words, the focus has shifted a little from the timeless elements of the romance to the timely ones, the medieval contexts that can illuminate the romance and the issues that the romance can illuminate. From the late 1990s on, critics have tended to gush less about the text's unique gender politics and instead worked to reinsert it into its own contexts, literary, historical, and cultural. We see a lot of topics like category crisis, rank in the ideology of social hierarchy, feudal inheritance law, saints' lives, manuscript illumination, the wild man tradition, the minstrel tradition, lyric discourse, medieval didacticism, humor, manuscript studies. And here, for example, you can see a little bit of writing in the margin of the manuscript that identifies an owner as Se Viva et Madame de la Valle. The gender topic is in no way sidelined, since it would be hard to talk about Silence without reference to that dimension of the plot. But scholars simply absorb gender studies in a variety of other perspectives on the romance. Performances. Silence, the romance, thematizes the musical performance of the narrative in the episode where he runs away with the minstrel. And it has begun to generate a variety of performance versions, from early music performances to new compositions, and from theater to storytelling. Each new incarnation of the romance focuses on a different dimension of the text and adds a new dimension to our understanding of it. In the late 1990s, John Flegel and Shira Common performed Le Roman de Silence as a lyric. discarded the romance's stuffy and shrill narrator in favor of a new storytelling persona, a canny old lady with a kerchief, a staff, and a gratuitous but entertaining Cockney accent that places her at a certain end of the spectrum. She uses that shrewd figure to highlight some of the text's discrepancies that the author left unaddressed. An audio version of this performance is available, and Hydock performs her hour-long version all over the country. Please invite her here. You won't be sorry. A modern oratorio by Catherine Saxon, The Return of Silas, portrays just 200 lines of the romance when Silas returns to his parents' home in disguise after spending 4 years as a minstrel. Saxon pans back from the gender plot to identify to identity in general, and she says, quote, "More than focusing specifically on the disadvantages of being a woman in a man's world, I was trying to capture the danger of being someone other than yourself." Silas, as a good child, follows her parents' instructions so well that she is almost killed for it. She has disguised her true self beyond recognition and is about to be put to death. The tragedy of Silas is that she can never be fully herself, woman, minstrel, and knight. And her silence at the end of the romance, and her silent presence on stage at the end of my oratorio, when everyone else joins in the chorus of "My heart is full of joy," is the symbol of her ultimate defeat, despite her best efforts, unquote. Kate Jackson's tragedy of silence carries us into yet another interpretive area, the drastic reworking, even travesty or denaturing of the text in very productive ways for modern audiences. Silence in hiding in modern interpretive fictions. Although the Romance of Silence seemed to leave French medievalists cold for a couple of decades, its plot seems to have spoken quickly to novelists writing in French. Tahar Benjelloun's L'Enfant de Sable, The Sand Child, set in Marrakesh, and Jacques Bourgeois' Le Chevalier Silence have palpable ties to the medieval text, if no clear resemblance to it. Benjelloun's protagonist is Ahmed, who is born Sarah, the eighth daughter born to a man who declares her to be a boy and raises her to be a boy to gain a male heir. Like Silence, the boy who is a girl goes along with the deception and inhabits a masculine identity. Unlike Silence, he marries. After Ahmed's father dies and his bride dies, the narration divides. Several different versions are proposed by tellers who all claim to be witnesses of the story. The narration explodes into a clamor of competing tellers and rival voices. The splintering of the narrative voices and the disintegration of certainties, which that multiplication of perspectives brings with it, harks back to the radical undecidability which its first critics associated with Le Roman de Silence. Jacques Bourgeois's novel Le Chevalier Silence, The Knight Silence, an adventuresome times, is a love story between two children. It's very playful in its language and concentrates on the relation between words and things or words and named beings. Ultimately, the narrative is organized around the impossibility of changing anything definitively through the artifice of name. Is there a causal relationship between reference and signs? What might it be? And here you can see this kind of meta-narrative attention that this narrator gives to the story. Instead of telling the story, he talks about how the story is going to proceed and how we are going to proceed as readers. Now the story has made a choice. That's how it always is, a crossroads in a wood, etc. And he tells us not to spend too much time on certain chapters because others are pressing close behind. Rubeau's linguistic play echoes that of Helder's Cornwall. Moira Bouffier, like Rubeau, announces her debt to romance in the very title of her award-winning play, Silence, Silence, which has been performed a lot in England and the US. The play, set around the end of the first millennium, does not reproduce the plot of the medieval romance, but the various plot points are kaleidoscopically reassembled. Amid the chaos of Viking raids and end-of-millennium panic, Silence, the young lord of Cumbria, is forced to marry a French princess. On their wedding night, both are horrified to discover that Silence is actually a girl, who until that point has been ignorant of herself. The two women realize they must hide the secret or risk losing the seat of Cumbria, so they flee to the north, along with a fearsome tyrant Ethelred, a French maid, the warrior Eric Longshaft, and a priest named Roger. Benjamin, Rubeau, and Buffini have taken the plot out of its time and into ours in many ways. That portability is what made it sing to critics in the first place. And the last section of the talk looks at modern analogs, not at all causally related to Seamoss, but closely related to it conceptually. You can't go a break these days without reading a book or a movie about the intersection between nature and nurture, sex and gender, sexuality and identity. Our medieval author had a head start of 700 years on modern interrogations of the relative weight of nature and nurture in determining gender identity and character and destiny, as well as on modern thinking about the performative dimension of gender and the inequality of the sexes before the law. I'll close by connecting the romance to a few analogous modern cultural productions that confront the same issues. This section is divided into cross-dressing for advantage, cross-dressing to express sexual identity, and intersexuality. Seamoss's parents made the extreme decision to raise that daughter as a boy for the advantage that a male heir brought to the family. Nowadays, popular culture mostly transfers that decision onto the protagonist herself, meaning that cross-dressing isn't a lifelong performance. It starts in adolescence or young adulthood. It's particularly well represented in young adult fantasy and fiction. I'll just mention a few earlier cases. Mulan goes to war to keep her aged father from being drafted. As an unsuccessful girl, Mulan has little to lose and everything to gain by the deception. In the Barbara Streisand film Yentl, based on Isaac Bashevis Singer's story Yentl the Sheba Boy, the protagonist is also unsuccessful as a girl, but pretends to be a young and pretends to be a young man to be allowed to study the Torah and the Talmud. In Shakespeare in Love, Violet is fully supplied with female graces, cross-dresses because she wants above all else to act on the stage. In Louise Erdrich's luminous novel, The Last Report on the Miracles at Little Known Horse, Sister Agnes lives an entire life as Father Damien Modeste, minister to the Ojibwe on the reservation. In letter after letter, Father Damien reports back to the unresponsive Vatican from Pius X to John Paul II, in letters that we read. Like Yentl or Vila, Father Damien loves this work that would be forbidden to him as a woman. These stories of cross-dressing for advantage tend to address the surface inequalities which are inequities between men and women. Their protagonists cross-dress to gain access to education, independence, travel, the priesthood, artistic self-expression, social stability or prestige, safety in moments of chaos or crisis, or other desirable benefits. We don't see so many adventures nowadays in which girls cross-dress to follow their love and protect them, as we did in the little cabin boy ballads of the 17th century. The cross-dressing for advantage stories seem to focus more on escaping the constraints and disadvantages of women's lives than on following a lover. But Rita Mae Brown's 1986 novel, High Hearts, does follow that cabin boy model. A woman follows her husband to fight in the Civil War, but there's a twist. The wife turns out to be far the superior soldier, and war is her unexpected path to fulfillment. The husband is a poetry-loving pacifist, and their new roles tear their marriage apart. A second category of stories is of adults who cross-dress as an expression of sexual identity and sexuality, as in the film based on a true story, Boys Don't Cry. Tina Brandon was a young woman who loved women, and in taking on the clothing, demeanor, and sexual behavior of Brandon Tina, she was living her true identity, what the medieval romance would have called nature. The film explains to us in detail, in the specific narrative strategies of film, the complex and urgent nature of Brandon's desire. The Roman de Silence, by contrast, is reticent. It leaves enormous gaps that make the text portable to our own time and place. The romance reveals to us nothing about the protagonist's sexuality. The story never shows Silence desiring anyone, or even hint at whom he would desire, male or female, were desired to arise in him, in her. Jones's only thoughts of physical sex were that he would be the loser in any encounter with a woman because of his lack of male genitalia, or in any encounter with a man because of his lack of feminine softness. But reticence. Is the essential feature that romance shares with myth. What the story doesn't tell us, later periods can fill with plot and meaning. Silence can be a story about sexual identity and even about sexual indeterminacy, precisely because it does not tell us too minutely what motivates its various characters. And this brings us to the third silence analog in modern fiction and nonfiction, intersexuality. An individual may present such contradictory sexual markers as to be neither unequivocally male nor female. Ambiguous genitalia may or may not be present, chromosomal anomaly always is. The brilliant novel Middlesex by Jeffrey Ioannidis makes intersectionality both a narrative fact and a narrative figure. A narrative fact, quote, I was born twice. First as a baby girl on a remarkably smallless Detroit day in January of 1960. And then, again, as a teenage boy in an emergency room near Petoskey, Michigan, in August of 1974. A narrative figure for the identity flux and infusion of intergenerational transformation through immigration. A genetic male, Callie, is born sexually ambiguous and brought up female until in adolescence, what she calls her crocus, blossoms into a full-fledged penis, and she becomes Cal. His genetic anomaly is attributed to an incestuous marriage between two siblings, Cal's grandparents, when they fled Smyrna in the 19-teens. In other words, it has a precise trigger when it is associated with a powerful taboo, not a morally neutral or random medical anomaly, and in this way it's a straightforward, but far from unproblematic, narrative solution. A cause celebre in the 1970s is that of a boy who was mutilated watched circumcision in 1967. David Reimer was raised as being Brenda and was brandished apparently in the scientific literature as evidence that gender is not innate but malleable from birth. Events in this case went otherwise though. The child was never comfortably female, and on discovering his history, he became defiantly a man. John Colapinto's book attributes Reimer's troubled life and his suicide to the nightmarish deception to which he was subjected and the instability caused by living an identity which did not match his psyche. The book title, As Nature Made Him, The Boy Who Was Raised as a Girl, eerily echoes the belong to Simons even to the term boy who was a girl by its case in scene. This case study is no more neutral than the earlier pro-nurture ones were. David Reimer is now brandished as proof that gender is biological and binary, that nature trumps nurture every time. Again, the medieval romance's reticence, its refusal to adjudicate, makes it more appropriately complex than that simplistic and politically charged formula, it's not nice to fool Mother Nature. The medieval romance, in fact, reflects the complexities and the long-running controversy surrounding South African runner Caster Semenya. Semenya is a phenomenal athlete, profiled both in the New Yorker and in the scholarly journal Feminist Studies. She was accused of being genetically male. If what was leaked to the press is in any way accurate, she may have external female genitalia but no uterus or ovaries. She may have undescended testes. She may have a chromosomal anomaly or enzyme deficiency that kept her body from developing male figure of features in response to signals from the Y chromosome. In any case, it is the possibility that she might have a testosterone advantage, which once resulted in her being banned from competing this, mutan is mutan, this is pretty much the conclusion that any romance reaches. It's complicated. We can't tell. There are no simple answers. Conclusion. I mentioned earlier that the romance can and should be studied as a timely text, that is, a text composed for a certain time and place and context different from ours. That's the research end of the stick, the attempt to shed light on the work itself and on the worldview that it vehicles and reflects. But it also needs to be studied as a timeless text, a story that can flow free of the North French feudal society of the 1200s and rub shoulders with us in our own day and with our own perplexities. That's the creative end of the stick, where we value continuities as much as, or even more than, divergence or alterity. The Roman de Silence author knew nothing about DNA and hormones, we're clear on that. He may have known something about indeterminate sex, and he certainly knew something about the irascible nature of gender identity. Whether he was thinking about these dynamics in terms that we apply, as he wrote his tale of nature and nurture, sex and gender, his story is large enough and capacious enough to help us think through analogous problems in the terms that we have devised for ourselves. We're living through a period in which the complexity of gender, of sexual identity and gender identity is becoming visible to a larger public, with the predictable backlash that this entails. It's complicated. We can't tell. There are no simple answers. And with this, I return to my starting point. The Roman de Silence, with its cross-dressing problem and its over-interrogation of the relationship between biological sex and gender identity, is a compelling tale for our own period. It speaks to our fascination with the nature of gender roles and their insertion into society and ideology. The exploration of gender is labile, unstable, and rooted in performance rather than simply in biology. The nature of gender identity in a world of strongly prescribed and hierarchical roles, and the nature of identity in general, both perceived and felt, performed and constitutive, public and private. We often seem to hope that science will solve all our mysteries for us. It won't. There will always be mysteries, and if anything, science will multiply them for us. What we get from stories are the means to think through those mysteries and to come to terms with them. Thank you.
Imogen Stubbs, as Silence, can be wonderfully masculine in her appearance and wonderfully feminine. I mean, she's convincing as a woman who has the beauty of a thousand other women, as nature says she gave to Silence, but she can also have a very strikingly masculine look to her. The thing about actors, though, is they can turn themselves into anything. A good one can be, it could really be anyone who can do it convincingly. But she'd be my favorite.
Please join me one more time.